Good morning, everyone, and happy Sabbath.
Morning.
It's truly a blessing for us to be here, amen.
Amen.
God has been good to us. He has kept us safe. We are still alive.
Yes.
And thank God in our right minds, amen.
Yes.
What a blessing that is. I am told that a prophet's concern is to take his duty as a prophet, is to take the concerns of God to the people. A priest takes the concerns of the people to God, and vice versa. He is a go-between, a mediator between God and the people. Whenever one has been called to speak a word for God, it's an awesome responsibility. Jeremiah regretted the day that he was born because he was standing between a wayward people and a righteous God. And he said, I did not sign up for this. It's not only an awesome responsibility, it's a tremendous privilege to be able to speak a word for the Lord. Amen?
Yes.
And I trust that for the next few minutes that you will stay with me. Amen?
Amen.
Now, David recognized early in his life that he was not smart enough. He was not wise enough. He did not have it up yet. And being a shepherd, he learned quickly that sheep aren't very smart. As a matter of fact, you have never seen sheep in a circus. Basically, they are dumb animals, defenseless. And he said in Psalm 23, one of these days I'm going to bring a message on Psalm 23. And he said, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restored my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, do I walk through the valleys and the shadows of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And the sooner we realize that, we will be better off. That God is our shepherd. There is only one true shepherd. And he is the only one who knows the right path.
Amen.
And I hope that I'm not going to tell you when I'll be speaking on that message on Psalm 23. But you need to be here, amen. You know, when I think about Jesus, it's amazing. I'm told that in Genesis they call him Shiloh. In Exodus they call him the I Am. In Numbers they call him the Staff Scepter. In Deuteronomy they call him the Rock. Joshua called him the Captain of the Lord's Host. Psalm they call him the Great Shepherd. The Proverbs they call him the Beloved. Isaiah says he's a wonderful counselor and the Prince of Peace. Zechariah said he is the branch. Micah said he is the one who is God, Father of all, is from everlasting to everlasting. Malachi said he's the messenger. Matthew called him Savior. Mark called him Son of Man. Luke called him the Great Physician. John says he was the Word made flesh. Acts says, at that name, every knee shall bow, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Thessalonians tells us that he will descend from heaven. Hebrews says that he is the great high priest, who is touched with the feelings of my infirmities, who was tempted in all points like Isaiah, yet without sin. Jude said he's able to keep me from falling and to present me faultless before his presence with exceeding joy. John said in Revelation that he is the Spirit and the Bride. He is the Alpha and the Omega. That's the first and last letters of the Greek alphabet. He is King of Kings and he is Lord of Lords.
Amen.
He is a heart fixer. He's a mind regulator. He's a bridge over troubled waters. He's a rock. He's a shield. He's a wheel in the middle of the wheel.
Amen.
He's a doctor in the sick room. He's a lawyer in the courtroom. He's all that and more. So what should we fear? There is no height, no depth, no principality, no power, no things present, no things to come shall be able to separate us from the love of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
He loves us with an everlasting love, and he promised that he will never leave us nor forsake us. When we lose sight of that promise, then we begin to fear. Mm. We have nothing to fear, Marty. You may not have the faith to be a martyr now, but the key is, if we are faithful now, we will be faithful then.
Amen.
If we are wishy-washy now, we'll be wishy-washy then. When it comes time for us to be in a position, God will give us the faith.
Yes.
If we are faithful in the little things.
Yes.
Amen. So my concern is not to worry about what will come. It's to worry about whose hands are you in.
Wow.
Amen.
Amen.
See, a basketball in the hands of Michael Jordan was worth millions. A basketball in my hands probably worth $5 or $6. It's in whose hands it's in. And we are engraved in the palm of his hand. Amen. That makes us valuable. That makes us important. That makes us precious in the sight of God. We are the apple of his eye. Amen. So we have what we are valued in the sight of God. We are somebody special in Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. Let us never forget that.
Amen.
Now, for those of you who love titles, I've entitled the message, The Dilemma of Grace. And I hope you will stay with me. See, it's a blessing. Amen.
Amen.
Shall we bow our heads as we pray? Father in heaven, as we come before your throne of grace, we ask your blessing upon us. As you are about to open your words upon our minds and give us understanding, may we learn something that will draw us closer to you. Speak to me, through me, and for me. May your words elicit from us a response to serve you. Father in heaven, may your truth be riveted into every fiber of our lives. May it have sanctifying effect on our characters. And let your name be glorified. Let your people leave this place blessed, justified in your sight. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
The dilemma of grace. A friend of mine, grace is a fundamental concept amongst those of us who call ourselves Seventh-day Adventists. It is a companion to a law of God which leads out a very clear and non-deviating path. See, grace accommodates that which we are unable to do according to the law. In that, it gives us an opportunity to rectify many of the mistakes that we made. The story is told of a man who operated a small business. He got his employees together and they came up with some rules. One of the rules was, if you are tardy 3 times, you will be dismissed from employment. It's not for us to decide whether 3 was the right number. This is what they had agreed on. Amen?
Amen.
We'll call up Mary for the sake of our discussion. One morning while Mary was getting ready to leave home, her daughter became desperately ill. And attending to her daughter's needs, doing the right thing, when she arrived at work, her employer met her at the door and says to her, "You are late." Grace allowed her to continue her employment. On a second occasion, when Mary was on her way to work, unforeseen, unbeknown to her, there was automobile traffic. And there was nothing that she could do about it. When she arrived at work, her employer met her at the door and said to her, "You are late." Grace allowed her to continue her employment. It had been a long time. And one day, while Mary was on her way to work, there was a terrible automobile accident. And something conjured up in Mary, telling her that she had been late twice. By doing the right thing, she stopped and tried to offer some assistance to those injured before medical help could arrive. When she arrived at work, her employer met her at the door. He said to her, "You are late." He helped her gather her things together, and he dismissed her from employment. If you are tardy 3 times, you will be dismissed from employment. When I heard about that situation, I became incensed. That is insensitivity. Just after 9-1-1, and I'm sure that every one of us here, you could recall where you were and what you were doing at that time, on that particular day. And soon after, some weeks and months transpired, and the country was still in a state of shock. And believe you me, this country had never been the same after 9-1-1. I can tell you that it was a paradise. The freedom we had, and after 9-1-1, it's a tremendous change. Anyway, many folks were being unemployed and companies were being stalled. My employer came to me and he said to me, "B, I'm also going to have to cut half of my staff." And that didn't worry me because I was a good worker. But then I get thinking, I was the only one employed. Now, if you're the only one employed, and he says he's going to have to cut half of his staff, then that gives you a little concern, amen?
Amen.
But I point your attention to a scripture reading that was read so ably by the elder.
Ray.
I forgot his name.
Yeah.
Ray. Ray. In Genesis chapter 2. "And the Lord commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but," now the word "but" is a conjunctive injunction. See, the word "but" changes that which has gone before from that which is to come. Are we together? "Of all," and the Lord commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it. In the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die." Now Adam was the federal head of the human race. There was no fine prince written in this agenda, in this contract. There were no loopholes in this covenant. There was no hidden agenda here.
Amen.
You see, friend of man, God means exactly what he says. Adam had one strike against it. In the day that you eat, you shall surely die. When God says do, he means do. Amen?
Amen.
When he says don't, he means don't. Reinforcing it is Romans 3:23, which says, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Because he was the federal head of the human race, God created the human race in Adam. Adam means mankind. Adama means dirt. He was created from red dirt. And when Adam sinned, he plunged the whole human race in sin. So we sin in Adam. So everybody born after Adam, sin was born back. Something was wrong with our birth. We were born in a mixed up, messed up situation. We were born condemned, we were born lost, we were born separated from God. In other words, you don't make a decision to be in the pit. All you had to do was to be born. I'm from Trinidad. I did not go to my parents and say it's time for me to be born. You are an American. Some of you didn't go to your parents and say, it's time to be born.
Amen.
As a matter of fact, you have nothing to do in the birth. As a matter of fact, you were born quite a while before you even realized that you were even born. And that automatically makes you an American. When I hear people say, I'm proud to be an American, how can you be proud of something that you have nothing to do with? How can you? You had nothing to do with being born.
Amen.
All you had to do was to be born and you became an American because you have been born. We are born in sin, shaped in iniquity, and all have sinned.
Yeah.
All we had to do was to be born. And we have been born back. Something is wrong with the first birth. Amen?
Amen.
I have another message I'm going to speak on. Let me give you a hint. God cannot forgive sin.
Amen.
He forgives the sinner.
Very good.
Listen to me. Sin must be paid for.
Amen.
We can pay the price, but we cannot pay the price and live.
Very good.
Amen.
Amen.
If you want to hear the rest of that message, you need to be here. Amen? There's a big difference.
Amen.
And we have a misunderstanding about this.
Very good.
The situation about sin. God forgives the sinner.
Amen.
Amen. And the nature in which we come into this world cannot and will not change. That nature must die.
Very good.
Jesus said, that which is born of flesh is flesh. The flesh does not change. The flesh must die. And that which is born of spirit is spirit.
Amen.
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 You see, some of us have been in the church for 18 years. And I've tried having, not you folks are intelligent. Sometimes you try having an intelligent discussion with people who have been in the way. And you are amazed that they are just barely on the surface. It's amazing. And these people are in the way.
Very good.
Sometimes it's hard to get out of the way.
Amen.
And let God's church move on. Amen?
Amen.
That's what Jesus says we must
about
be born again.
Talking
again.
Am I speaking truth?
Amen.
Yes.
Folks, you need to look at me if you're not listening to me. Amen?
Amen.
God loves every single one of us. And there's a hymn that says, what a thrill that I feel when I get together with God's wonderful people. It's a blessing. And imagine the hustling during the week. And there's of employment, the contention, the strife, the uneasiness. It's a good thing when we can get together with God's wonderful people.
Amen.
What a privilege it is. People who are like-minded. People who can lift you up and build you up and encourage you and hold up your hands. Amen. People who can speak blessing in your life.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
A blessing is a spoken word for your health, your happiness, your prosperity. That's a blessing. Amen.
Amen.
The wages of sin is death. See, God was trying to establish a clear line between light from darkness, between truth and error, between righteousness and unrighteousness, between obedience and disobedience. Just as Mary found herself outside the boundaries of her company, many of God's people, in their quest for God and to be like Him, are victims of sin in the flesh. And oftentimes we violate the laws of God. But the amazing, marvelous grace of God moves in, that comes to us in the person of Jesus Christ, and affords every sinner to overcome the sin that is in him, that is in her. That comes through Christ. Amen?
Amen.
There's a power outside of ourselves that comes from above. Jesus is the answer.
Amen?
Amen. For the crisis that we have found ourselves in. There is, however, in this contemporary age, because of our knowledge of Scripture, because of our familiarity with the spirit of prophecy, we have a tendency to believe that God doesn't always mean what He says. And therefore will not always do what He says that He will do. Many of us, we are often captives of our own personal subjective agenda.
Amen.
And so we are not always on time, including me. You see, when I speak to us, when I speak to you, first I speak to myself.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
We are not always on time when we could be on time.
Oh.
Oftentimes we do not embrace the full integrity of God because the awesome mercy of God is so good and so great. Surely God will not hold me captive by law, because grace is available. We believe, as God's children, that the law is there to guide us, to direct us in the way that God will have us to go. And the grace of God is there to compensate for us that which we cannot do. We often quote Isaiah chapter 55 and verse 1, which says, "Ho, everyone that thirsted, come ye to the waters, and he that had no money, come ye, buy and eat. Yea, come, buy milk, wine and milk without money and without price." We would like to remind people that the grace of God is sufficient to accomplish that which we cannot do. We further like to tell people God does not save us by the good that we do,
Amen.
But rather God saves us by virtue of the faith we have in Christ, who has done good in our behalf.
Amen.
These things are good to know, friend of mine. However,
yes.
God does not only require a strictness in deeds done, but God requires from us an attitude, a state of mind that allows us to accommodate the will of God, no matter how much we are inconvenienced by it.
Wow. Amen.
Whenever God asks us to do something, He gives us the power to do it.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
There should be no argument, no discussion, no excuse to what God says. God is never wrong. He can never make a mistake. He doesn't gather statistics like you and I. Whenever He says things, He's always right. He's always fair. He's always just. And if God says it, I believe it, and that settles it.
Amen.
That spirit must be born again amongst those of us who call ourselves God's children.
Amen.
God loves us. Amen.
Yes.
You know, Jesus gives us a command to go into all the world. I remember when I first embraced the knowledge of Christ, the message. I was very shy. Coming from Hinduism and embracing this message, I was taught, I was educated, it was engraved in my memory, that we belong in this religion where we are born in. Hindu never leaves his faith. You're born in Hinduism, you're gonna die as a Hindu. There's a song in Hindi which says, Mera Jhoota Hai Jhoopana, Patalon Hindustani, Sapalato Pursu Parbadel Hai Hindustani. Which means, my shoes may be Japanese, my trousers English, my hat may be Russian, but my heart is still Indian. It takes a miracle. Whenever somebody comes to Jesus, it's a miracle. It is not accident, it is not by chance. There is something called transformation. And the things I used to do, I did not find myself doing it. I could have tried until I get blue in the face. For 1,000 years, it would never become a reality. But the grace of God, the power of Jesus moves in.
Yes.
And accomplish that which was I was unable to do.
Amen.
In my own strength.
Amen.
Every kind word, every good deed, every thought, every action, that is a blessing to others, come from above. We don't have an innate goodness in us. We don't have an innate goodness to do any good thing.
Amen.
That power comes from Jesus.
Yes.
There is nothing good in none of us. All our righteousness is as filthy rags.
Amen.
It's not talking about all the bad we do. It's talking about all the good we do.
Amen.
It's filthy rags in the sight of God. But oftentimes we take the grace of God too lightly. If you do it, it's a sin. If I do it, it's a mistake. We rationalize and we reason. But God says in Isaiah 1:18, come now, let us reason together. In other words, let's talk about this. Amen.
Amen.
He's a reasonable God. He said, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, and crimson is a double dye, they shall be as white as wool. Only Jesus can do that. Amen?
Amen.
I've seen a friend of mine in the lives of hardened criminals. And by the way, the doors that are open today will be closed tomorrow. If we neglect to do what God asks us to do in peaceful time, if we cannot contend, if we cannot run with the footmen, how can we contend with the horsemen? If we cannot make it when the Jordan is low, how can we make it when the Jordan overflows its banks? Talk, my friend, is cheap.